Hello, everyone. This is Lisa Wozniak with Woz Marketing, and I'm so blessed today to have Kimball Stanler from Top Dog Performance. Kim is a social media coach and marketing strategist who helps her clients create marketing initiatives that clearly identify the perfect target audience, meaning that you can't be all things to all people all the time, right? She defines the message and maps out exactly how to reach your ideal audience, whether it's through social media presence, a well-designed landing page with an insightful download tool, or even e-newsletters that inform and act as a lead magnet. Kimball has an incredible gift for reverse engineering the sales process. She can look at an audience persona and define exactly how they enter the sales funnel, evaluate the messaging, and nail down a call to action, which is essential in getting a client closer to the conversion. Kim says keeping them on the hook is what it's all about long after the initial sale has been completed, and her motto is, there are riches in niches. Boy, if that isn't the truth. It's all about helping clients create digital breadcrumbs. I love that. So businesses get found and new sales are generated. She's a huge supporter of teaching people how to fish, and the social media platforms she loves are LinkedIn, Facebook, and Twitter. Kimball is the mom of two teenagers and a wife of 29 years. Congratulations. And she lives in sunny Florida and is a self-proclaimed food critic and aspiring painter. Welcome, Kimball.
Thanks for having me.
Oh my gosh, it's just a blast to have you here. You have so many tremendous, wonderful nuggets of information that I am dying for people to absorb from you. So if it's okay with you, we're going to get started because I know you've got a lot of great info to share.
Oh, thanks. No, and thanks again for having me on. So yeah, let's do this and have some fun.
Absolutely. So let's start out by talking about how you identified your specialty niche. How did you come upon that?
Oh, gosh. I would probably say years and years of being an entrepreneur myself. Years and years of helping and seeing people that are just struggling with getting overwhelmed. All the entrepreneurs that are getting overwhelmed with everything. We were just talking. I'm going to take you down that road. We were just talking and how exhausted we get as entrepreneurs. I mean, sometimes you have like 2 minutes to sit and your mind can't even catch up with what needs to take place. So that's what I saw all the time. They were exhausted. They were overwhelmed with marketing. They were spending money. They weren't getting results. And then what happens is they start what I call pitch slapping, where it's like, let's just slap the audience, more message. Why aren't they buying? And so I kept seeing all of these efforts that were just disconnected and trying to pull everything together and educate consumers and market professionals that say, yeah, I don't know where all the resources are and how much should I be spending for all of this? And how do I pull it all together? Because I got all these gaps, this one over here and this one over there. So that's how I got the market, was just listening to what they're frustrated with and then finding a process that I can pull it all together so I can say, okay, you know that board, The Game of Life? Remember The Game of Life?
Oh, yeah.
Where in the world do you start and then where do you go? This is not a crapshoot. There are major gaps in business. And if you're really good at it, like you, and I think I'm not so bad with it too.
I think so too.
You can look and say, you are here. What are you missing behind you? And what do you want to achieve ahead of you? And that's a long answer for a very short question, was how do you define the market? How did I define my clients? It was looking at all those people and saying, there's hope. You don't have to keep spending a ton of money. Let's work on your process. Those are the clients I usually work with. And it's just because of need in the marketplace, because they were so frustrated all the time.
Oh, absolutely. And I can completely identify with that as an entrepreneur myself, you know, and you and I are both in marketing. It doesn't take away the overwhelm just because we're in marketing, because you can, as an entrepreneur, you can become completely exhausted by the process. You know, you and I were just talking before we went on air about how you have several different projects going on at the same time and you're trying to keep all these balls in the air and making sure that you're doing a good job. But at the beginning and the end of that day is exactly what you had just said. There has to be a roadmap that will get you from point A to point Z. Otherwise, what you were talking about, it's just like throwing darts at a dartboard and people are going, oh my God, this isn't working. I'm investing all of this time, energy, and effort in my marketing and I'm not seeing the results that I want to see. Why isn't it working? So I'd like to talk a little bit about who your target market is. You touched on that briefly, but if you would, go into a little bit more depth on who your target market is, who you most like to serve, who your ideal clients are.
Sure. I work a lot with speakers. I work a lot with business coaches because they have that moving target going all over the place and every client is different, different need. So they have a different way of approaching things. Even those solo entrepreneurs that we were talking about too. So it's usually the individuals that don't have don't have more than two or even three team members. They're kind of doing it themselves and they're trying to figure it out. And some of them are just like, oh my gosh, you know, I've gone down this rabbit hole. I don't know how to get back out. So it's those individuals that are small business owners with less than three people that are trying to do it all themselves. And that, as you know, incorporates a heck of a lot of people. So yeah.
Oh, it certainly does. And that's a great target market to have because the need there is so great. You know, they have this idea and this vision for success and where they want to go, but again, back to the roadmap and how to get there. And they can become so overwhelmed, you know, because I think that some people think a lot of times that marketing is just this quick and easy thing, like with regard to social media. Oh, I'll throw a couple of posts up on Facebook and then my phone's going to start ringing, yeah. You know, and
there's so much. Let me just spend $5 on an ad and I'm sure I'll book a ton of sales. Hey, guess what, folks? Go buy Starbucks with that $5. You will have more satisfaction with Starbucks than your results if it's a one-day $5 ad. It's unrealistic. But, you know, you see all these, you know, flash in the pan, get rich, look at this, download this, and it just lures you in. The only ones that are getting rich are those people that are selling it to you.
Exactly. Exactly. And I think that's the biggest misconception for small business owners, for solopreneurs, is there's so much of that that type of marketing going on out there that will lead you to believe that it's quick and easy and you'll be rich in 30 days. And it really disheartens me to see that and to see folks get caught up in that and buy into that. It just breaks my heart.
I had a speaker that I worked with. I got her on board after she had spent in 3 years before me, $100,000.
Oh, Lord.
And I'm sitting there saying, okay. And I do something that's called a collateral inventory, and I will probably get to that, but it's a great exercise for everybody to do. So I said, all right, let's sit down. I want to know what you have is all these little tools, whether it be an ebook or, you know, a white paper or a brochure, a business card, you know, what's all your stuff? $100,000 she paid for very little collateral. And all these people that said, hey, for one person she spent $30,000 on to work with as a coach, and she still had to do all the work.
Oh my gosh.
Someone, please. I wanted to get like a paper bag and start going. Just listening to what she was doing. So, you know, it was really frustrating. And I just got her back on track and hey, let's breathe. You got some things that you can work with. Let's just connect the dots.
Absolutely. You know, we touched on some of the pain points already that folks are going through before they come to you. Can you just give us a little bit more of a feel for specifically how you help your target market? What are some of the things that you can do for them?
A big thing, and those pain points, a big thing that I see, and many of us suffer. And if you go to a, if you go to whoever goes watching this, you go to a networking meeting. If they say, if they give you an opportunity to say who you are and what you do, and if this comes out of your mouth, I want to personally flick you in the head. So here it is. Yeah, I help. I'm looking for someone or anyone that's looking for, and then they just spew a brochure. Your target market is not someone or anyone. So niching, that riches and niches that you were saying before, that is a motto that I absolutely live. Who do you want to get to? So if you liken marketing to the game of Clue, and if you remember the game of Clue, and my favorite was, you know, it was a matter of a whodunit, murder mystery whodunit, for those people that don't know Clue or have no clue about Clue. So for me, it was three things. It was who did it, where did it take place, and what did they use to kill the person? I know it's a little morbid on a Friday, but hey, you know, we'll go with it. So it was Professor Plum in the library with a candlestick. That is marketing. It's who are you going after? Where do they hang out? And what are you going to use to get the message to them? That's it. So if you compartmentalize everything, that's how I start to help them all. Who are you looking for? That's your persona. You really have to nail it down. It's not someone or anyone. It really is. What do they look like? If you could videotape them sitting at Starbucks, or if they even would be at Starbucks, if you could videotape your prospect, what are their habits? What do they do? Who do they trust? Who do they go to? Where do they hang out? That's a persona. Everybody gets all, I think, wigged out about, oh, I have to do all this market research. Listen, if you don't know who you're targeting, you're wasting your money. Don't waste your money. Oh my gosh, we don't have any money to waste.
Absolutely. So you help them identify their niche market.
How are they going to get the sales? What's that sales message? Like, what are the steps? What do they have to do? If this person, how do they, where are they at? Are they at Facebook? Are they, networking at your group? And what do you want to offer to them so that they can come into the fold of what you do? And so is that through a download piece? Is it through your website? Do you want them to subscribe to, you know, something, a newsletter? And then once they're in that fold, how do you take care of them and how do you nurture them? And that's called a sales funnel, as you know very well. But, you know, how do you take care of them? And then where are all those touch points? Like, how do you keep them on that hook? And how do you get them closer to a sale? So all of those things are what I take a look at. So you have that. There's nothing worse than getting someone on a mailing list and you don't talk to them for 6 months.
Absolutely. You know, yeah, consistency is key, isn't it?
It is. And people will start reporting you as spam.
Yeah. Oh, for sure. Yeah.
So I help them with all of that. How do you touch them? Where are they going? And then how do you bring them into the fold? And then how do you help them with the next step? How do you get them closer to that sale and interacting with you?
That's fantastic. So how has the work that you've done with your clients impacted their business? So how was their business different as a result of them working with you?
Increase in Google Analytics. You can see how many people are going or driving traffic to the website. Obviously higher sales. Their mailing lists are growing. So now you can, you know, even we all have different ways in which we buy. And, you know, there's a trust factor. So you have to earn that trust. They need to get to know who you are and what your message is. And so that might be the different messages on the email list. So they're growing their mailing list so they can continue to reach out and then, you know, talk to them about something else. So it's conversations. It's also engagement. Engagement goes way up on Facebook, on Twitter, even on LinkedIn. I love LinkedIn. But there's certain conversations you should have on LinkedIn. And then there's certain conversations that you have on Facebook. So having that engagement goes up is an experience too. I just had a client of mine, she had 400% increase on her hits in 1 month.
That's fantastic.
On her website. And it's
that
just
fantastic.
We drove business, not in a pushy way.
Right.
We did funny signs, and we found it was a sign company, and we found all these funny signs, not inappropriate. They're all G-rated. I don't know. I would have not been G. Maybe I would have been PG, but they're all G-rated. And we put some of them on our website. We put a whole bunch on Facebook, and we just had people interact and have a good time. People want to be entertained, and they want to be educated, and they want to get to know you. Like, Facebook is friends talking. It's not, hi, buy this. And then the next day, since you didn't buy this, buy this. Have a conversation. That's why people go on Facebook. So if you want to be integrated into that conversation with friends, act like one.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I like the fact that earlier you were talking about building that like and trust factor and building that into the relationship, because at the end of the day, people buy from people that they like and trust.
That's right.
And so you have to earn that over time. That doesn't happen by blasting a bunch of marketing in their face. And I mean, I know that you know this, but I always use this little analogy of when I'm talking to people, imagine yourself at a cocktail party. And you're talking to somebody who only wants to talk about themselves. They only want to talk about their business, and they're shoving their sales strategy down your throat. 5 minutes into the conversation, you're looking for the nearest exit sign.
Yeah. Okay.
You know, I mean, that is just the worst. So your marketing approach should have the same impact. You should be taking the time to get to know your audience and to build that like and trust. And, you know, the analogy works out the same way in the end, you know?
And be real. This is, you know, if it's a matter of, you know what, I really could use a few extra clients to help them with blah, 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 you know, whatever it is that you sell. And, you know, if you know of a person that's really struggling with, and then you fill in whatever it is, I'd like to be introduced to them. But
absolutely.
You gotta be specific, not someone or anyone. Specific.
I love that. Someone or anyone. That's priceless.
Someone or anyone. Unless that's their last name, that's not who they're going after.
That's priceless. I love it.
So, and don't be afraid to outsource. Outsource things. There are so many great, as you know, there are so many great places that you can go to get dirt cheap help with your marketing. If you're not creative, if you need a voiceover, if you need a logo. Oh my gosh, there are so many great resources out there. And with an inexpensive resource, you know, the old saying of you get what you pay for, not necessarily. You just have to do your homework and be very specific with what you want as an end result. Because if you're wishy-washy, what are they, a mind reader? They're not a mind reader. So you gotta be really specific with what you're looking for.
Very clear on the message, absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah.
Absolutely. So if you could give only one piece of advice to people with regards to marketing, what would that be?
Develop your business personality. And I know that sounds crazy, but you know, if your target market is friendly and your message isn't friendly, you're going to miss them. So I think being yourself and defining who your business is, if your business had a personality, going back to your example of you're at a cocktail party, would you want to hang out with your business personality?
Good point. Very good point.
Here's a new concept for us, you know?
So speaking of personalities, I understand that you have a really fantastic quote from your grandfather, is it?
Oh my God, my grandfather. He used to play the piano. He's since passed, obviously, but he used to play the piano in the vaudeville. You know, while they're up on stage, and he's like, okay, so he always used to have funny little sayings. And I know this sounds bad, but it's not meant to be bad. It says, his saying is, if at first you don't succeed, keep on sucking till you do succeed. So if you're really bad at something, so what? Get better and keep doing it. So if you don't succeed at it first, keep on stinking at it until you do succeed at it. So I think too many times we end up throwing our name in the, you know, throwing our towel in the ring and just saying, that's it, I tried it. Would you try it once?
Right.
Keep going at it. If you really have passion for it, keep going at it. Get some advice, get some feedback. Heck, call you. Call me. We love talking to people and helping them out. So,
but that's, you know, that's great advice though. I mean, you know, don't be afraid to fail forward.
Yeah.
You know, because so many times, and I know that I, from time to time, have a tendency to be guilty of this myself. I feel like I can't put something out there until it's 100% perfect. You know, you get caught in this trap of perfectionism, and really you end up hurting yourself in the long run. So, you know, I think that that's great advice. Just put yourself out there. Yeah. And keep going. Even if you fail, it's a way of learning what way not to do it, right?
Yeah. And you know what? Don't be afraid. Not everyone's going to ever just, you know, not everyone's going to agree with you. Who cares?
Right.
If you know you're serving a great need, if you know you're ethical and you know the value, you'd be proud of the fact that you've got something that'll help people. Be proud
Absolutely.
Of it.
Absolutely. Yeah, that's terrific advice. Now, listen, Kimball, I know that you've got some amazing stuff to talk about that you've got going on in your life moving forward, and I am just itching for people to hear about it. I understand you have a special event coming up in August. Can you tell us more about it?
Sure. Thanks for letting me do it, too. I have actually something that's called a writer's camp, and this is for people that have had a book brewing in their head. They either have put it on pencil and paper, or it's still just brewing in their head. And you don't get rich off of books, but you can get speaking engagements and credibility builds, and you can use it once again as that collateral and the tool. So it's a writer's camp, and it really stinks because it's in Florida.
Oh, darn.
You better come down. Yeah. So, and it's in August, and the concept is this. That I'm not facilitating, and I'm actually going to be there writing my own book along with this. So talk about practice what you preach. I got to get it done. And that's really where this whole thing came out of, because I am good friends with a ghostwriter. She's over in the St. Pete, Tampa area of Florida. And she's a ghostwriter. And this woman has, I think this year, she will have helped construct 20 books.
Holy smokes.
You think we're busy? Oh my God.
Yeah.
So she's a ghostwriter, and I said, listen, I know you do these writer camps up in New York City, and they're like $5,000 a piece. I can't afford that. How about we do a writer's camp and not make it as pricey? Everybody book their own rooms, and I'll get a great room, a great place with inexpensive room. If someone wants to room together, split it. And, you know, room together, meet someone, have separate beds, meet someone. And so we put together this writer's camp. And in 3 days, you leave with your first draft in hand, done, of your whole book.
That is amazing.
It's only 8 people because she cannot clone herself, and I'm not there to facilitate it. I brought in the expert that does this for a living. So you get expert advice and guidance by someone that's doing this for a living, and you leave with your first draft, which is phenomenal. And yeah, it's in Dunedin, Florida. It looks like Dunedin. It is well worth the investment, in my opinion, because of what it will give you and what you get to do with it as your next draft.
Oh, absolutely. That is just amazing. I mean, yeah. So who's going to be the ideal candidate for this kind of event?
Ideal candidate is someone, I go back to that target market that I was mentioning to you. I deal a lot with speakers. So speakers, business coaches, nutritionists that have maybe a way of living, health and wellness coaches, people that might want to take this book and build their mailing list with it. And have it as an offer, or maybe they want to take this book and get on stage, or they want to take this book and do something bigger with it, or maybe they just want to do it because it's been itching and they've had it going on and they just want to get it out and they have a bigger mission. So I think it's people that want to use it to attract more business, as opposed to just someone like, yeah, I'd like to write a kid's book for my grandkids to. That's probably not the best person for this, because it's like, all right, you've done 42 pages and a kid will take a nap.
Right.
After 42 pages.
Oh my gosh.
Dr. Seuss. And unless you're J.K. Rowling's, you know, there's, it is, you typically don't get rich off of selling books. You can get a lot more income off of leveraging the book and using it as a marketing collateral piece.
Absolutely. So it's the gateway to more opportunity.
Without a doubt. So if that just spoke to you, I would love to have you. And again, it's only 8 people. That's it.
Yeah. That's big. I mean, you talk about the individualized attention that you'll be able to get with a group of 8 people. That's phenomenal. And I was about to ask you, why do folks need an event like this? But I mean, you had already covered the fact that it's a book is such a gateway to so many other opportunities, to speaking engagements, to going after the clientele that you thought maybe weren't going to be attainable for you. And so many opportunities come from that book. So for folks who are writing that first book for the first time and wanting to utilize it as that, I could see that this would be an amazing event for that. And like you had said, if there's folks that have had this in their brain for a while and just haven't been able to figure out how to execute it and get it down on paper, I can see how this would just be amazing. And the fact that you'll have the copy of it, you'll have your rough draft by the time the event is done. That is just phenomenal.
What you're learning too is you're learning, so if, like, for instance, I have 3 books that are in my head. I have one that's halfway written, but the rest of them are in my head. And what's really nice is it's not, she's teaching you the process of pulling it together. So you get this one under your belt, you're going to know, okay, now for my next one, what do I want to do? Maybe I don't want it this long. And maybe I want an ebook and it's only 26 pages. And then I can do like a free download and do a landing page and all of that jazz. So it won't take me as long. But the art in writing and the art in crafting your message and the art in pulling it all together and how to lay it all out, that's what you're learning. That's what you're paying for. You're not paying for someone to say, oh, that's nice, I'll write it for you. She's not writing it for you. She's helping you write it so that you're learning. So it's really, that goes back to that. What I love is teach them how to fish. You're going to learn the process, which is a life skill that you can now go, boy, if you get really good at this, hey, consider, depending on what your business model is, maybe it's something that you want to offer as a window into helping others create a living legacy like a book. And it's a great credibility piece. And it's a great process to have under your belt because it helps you put your thoughts in order too for any aspect of your business. So I love it.
That's a good point. You know, I think that one of the ways that people will be impacted by attending an event like this is, number one, the confidence level. And number two, the structure level, the order in which the events need to take place in order for that to happen. And then I think that it kind of opens your mind to the possibility of what's attainable moving forward.
Yeah.
What you say?
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, again, it's you're learning the process. It's how rewarding is it that after 3 days you have something. Do you know how many times I've gone to a very expensive event and you leave there going, great information, but I don't know what the hell to do first.
Yeah. You leave those kind of events feeling more overwhelmed than you did when you went in there. Excited, but overwhelmed at the same time, right?
Yeah. And now this way, I mean, I'm telling you, it's 3 days. It's August 25th through the 27th. And it is 3 days and you are working. This is not like, all right, we're going to take a 3-hour martini lunch and go downtown Dunedin. No, you're working. We're catering stuff in. This is a working lunch. This is 8 hours a day. But on that Sunday at 5 o'clock, when you're like, oh my gosh, my brain's dead. Well, your book's done. Well, at least your draft is. Your whole first draft, all laid out, all done, and you leave with it. How cool is that?
It is so cool. So cool and absolutely amazing. So can you tell us, where can people go to find out more about this event and sign up?
I don't know if you'll have a link on whatever you do, but it's a little long, but it's topdogperformance.net/Florida Writers, with an S, Camp. Florida Writers Camp. And I'm going to have a big, talking about not having it all perfect yet, there'll be a huge link on the front of my website that'll give you immediate direction if you, you know, want to rewind that and write it down again. It's floridatopdogperformance.net/Florida Writers Camp.
Or they can go to your website, topdogperformance.com.
.net.
Oh, topdogperformance.net, and get the link directly that way as well.
You got it. Just look for it. It'll be a big box. It'll look like a Las Vegas-shaped sign, and it'll say Florida Writers Camp. You won't be able to miss it.
Fantastic. Well, thank you so much, Kimball, today for coming in and sharing your ideas and your brain with us and talking about this amazing event. So, folks, if you've been sitting on the idea of writing a book and just haven't been able to figure out where to get started or how the process works, I really encourage you to follow the link that Kim talked about or go to her website, topdogperformance.net, and register for this event. Again, remember, there's only going to be 8 people at this. So if you're thinking about it, now is the time to take action because this is going to fill up really fast. And when it fills up, it fills up. I mean, they're not going to offer additional events or additional weekends. This is a one-time only thing. So strongly encourage you to take advantage of that. Kimball, thank you so much for talking to us today. I've had such a great time and looking forward to talking to you a bit more and collaborating with you on different marketing opportunities. But thanks so much for your time. Folks, this is Lisa Wozniak with Woz Marketing, helping you navigate your yellow brick road.